Clock counting down at the bottom right corner of your screen as we watch them just prepare for their start sequence. We were talking about the teamwork, but there's also competition, and for a lot of people it's hard to understand this. You know, there's Kieran and Dorian working together, helping each other, and then they go out on the race course and they are competing against each other for one spot.
Yeah, they're good friends on the shore, but I'm pretty sure that when the starting gun goes, they're just each other's competitors.
Psychologically, I'm just interested in the mentality of that and how it's done, because it's not just in windsurfing. You see that time and time again across the classes.
Yeah, I think some people are really good at that and have the right mindset to do it, and it helps that they're really good friends, and other people have more difficulties with that. And I think they're just two guys that really enjoy windsurfing and really enjoy each other's company.
Okay, 4 minutes and 30 seconds to the start. Let's have a look at the course that they're going to be racing. In we fly to Aarhus, to the brand new International Sailing Centre, and this is what we can expect.
Yes, so we will start off with an upwind towards the first mark, and then we'll reach to the second mark, then a downwind. They can choose which gate they take. They go back up and then go down to the fifth mark and reach towards the finish line. So we'll do an outer loop course.
This is what we're in for. Some fabulous shots that have just come in off the water as they prepare to start their first race of qualifying, the Yellow Fleet in the RSX Men. And in the men's, 10 nations are trying to qualify for spots at Tokyo 2020. Overall here at the championships, 40% of the spots available across the classes at Tokyo 2020, 40% of them are up for grabs here in Aarhus. That's really what is at stake. That's what everybody's focus is, to qualify their nation. But I think we're going to be in for some fantastic action out there on the water. If these shots are anything to go by, conditions absolutely perfect. So we look out across the race course from the land, and I have to say we've got hundreds of people already sitting in the grandstand and along the shore watching these bright orange and yellow sails in the distance. Some real knowledge amongst the spectators here. It's a big sailing city, is Aarhus. They know what they're talking about, they understand what they're watching. And so, using the analytics, Jordan, how are things looking on that start line right now?
Well, she's a crazy old start line at the moment, mate. That's all I'm going to have to tell you. So we've got about 1.4 kilometre length top mark to the top mark. The start line is currently 70 metres advantage to the pin end. I've seen it up to 200 metres at the starboard end, and I've seen it to 100 metres at the port end, all in the last couple of minutes. We're seeing quite significant moves in the wind, big moves in strength, but up to 30 to 40 degree movements in just a few short minutes. So currently, the pin end is favoured slightly.
Now, just in the middle of that shot is Dorian van Rysselberghe, double Olympic champion, one of the most successful windsurfers there has ever been, and his sail number, so you can keep an eye on it, is Netherlands 8. 5 Spanish taking part in this Yellow Fleet, 5 Britons as well, including Tom Squires and Matt Barton, and also the European silver medalist from Greece. That's another one to keep an eye out for, Byron Kokolanis, and his sail number is Greece 8. So, with that start line set up as it is, what do they have to do?
Well, they're a unique vessel, the RSX. They're not going to go close to the wind like some of the other fleets that we're used to sailing. So the trick for these guys, and they do lose a lot of distance when they tack, okay, so the trick for these guys
is they have to pick a side. They really do, don't they, Evie? So they've got to pick a side, and whoever picks the right side, they'll try and do as few tacks as possible. Whoever picks the right side will be the ones coming out. So you get a clean start and then race to the first shift, basically. So they've got to know when that next shift is coming down, and it is incredibly volatile at the moment. We've probably stabilised slightly just looking at that wind at the moment.
So 5 seconds to go to the very first race of the World Championships for the RSX men. And they are away with the Briton out in front, followed closely by the Japanese at this close end, the pin end of the line. And double Olympic champion from the Netherlands in the middle of the fleet. You can just see him edging ahead as the majority. Well, I think there's a fairly good split, actually, between those going right and those going to the left-hand side of the course right now.
I'd feel that the majority of them is going towards the right side. There were a lot of them actually waiting on port tack at that starting line, and then just decided to cross over to the right side. And from the analytics at the moment, it looks like that's the right choice.
Just looking at it on screen, it looks like they're knocked on port too, doesn't it? So you'd have to go. You'd take off on starboard, and they're into that sort of racing mode. So when we had the close-up shots before, you could see just how much work the feet were doing. It's quite unique sort of setup. You've got to drive off that rail. You can see that leeward white rail is doing a lot of work, and they've got to make that fin work. So the centreboard comes up. So they have to load the fin without overloading the fin, otherwise the board will spin up. So you'll watch the back leg of the sailor. You'll see it slightly bent in that back knee, but the back foot and the leg actually do quite a lot of work to try and keep that load. They want to get that rig right back and charge. So if they're planing, they're going fast and they're also going high.
Yeah, what they're trying to do is just sail on the fin and minimize the drag so they go as fast as possible.
Yeah.
And at the moment, or earlier on, we could see that Dorian was going really, really fast on that right side.
The other thing is, if you go to the wrong side, because they're travelling so quickly, you're going to see quite significant differences in the leads, is what I would suggest as well. So something to watch out. So you might see situations where it looks like somebody's a long way behind, but just a tiny shift can make it change quite a bit. So
yeah, it's all about getting the board up to speed and then making the right decision on the lay line, because a tack can mean so much. Well, it will slow you down so much that you will lose a lot, actually.
Yeah. Actually, I'm going to try and do some comparisons on that later on once I've got a bit of data off. I'm interested. That was a fairly quick tack, but you still, that acceleration that you see, it takes a while. You've got to do all the pumping, the planing, and while they're doing that, they're not in that sort of high angle. They're not in that high groove, sort of charging closer to the mark. So most of the fleet that went to the left are starting to tack back, and half the fleet that have gone right are starting to tack back and come towards the centre. What do you reckon, Evie? Whose side's... It's just starting to bend slightly right since the start.
Yeah, it looks like the boards that are on the left side are actually sailing a pretty high mode, but it will depend on what the situation is on the right side. I think it's a little bit too early to drop
make a
into
call,
conclusions.
But they're charging. Just so you know, going upwind, they're sitting on around 14 and a half knots going upwind, which is, you know, what were we seeing? We're seeing about 8 knots with the FX, the 49 FX, and about 5 to 6 on the 470s. So just to give you some comparison. But then again, the angle that they're sailing is completely different. The other thing that happens on these things is there's a lot of variation in terms of the angles that you sail. So you can even see that on shot. You know, at some stage, they're not matching height for height. So sometimes you can go slightly lower and go a lot quicker, or slightly higher and go moderately slower. It's very fine detail here.
Yeah, I think the wind has definitely shifted towards the right. At the start, we were at 275, and at the moment, we're at almost at 300. So major right shift in that first part of the upwind, and that's why it looks like the right side is winning at the moment.
So the athletes and the coaches, that we saw so much of the fleet go off on a port hand start. they obviously worked that out. They were doing a good track, and they had a real strong idea of exactly what the numbers were. So that was pretty good to see. Everyone sort of got it fairly well dialed in. Most of the fleet are on starboard now, which tells you that exactly what Evie was saying, you know, it's right-hand shift at the moment. They're travelling pretty quick.
Yeah, between 12 and 15 knots.
Won't be too long till we hit that top mark. See, the Italian there is just on a nice little lift just at the top of the screen. I think he's probably close to the lead, just depending on how quickly the analytics is. We're still not decided, is it? Tom Squires from Great Britain. He's throwing an attack. You can see he's got to go back into that fleet.
Tom Squires actually has just moved into the top 10 now for Great Britain. But it's early days on this first leg, and the lead is changing, chopping and changing, as are the top 10 all the way down the fleet as well. It's a bit of snakes and ladders at the moment as the fleet begins to settle out and chooses their preferred course. But Louis Gillard and Dorian van Rysselberghe fighting it out for that leading spot. So it's the double Olympic champion from the Netherlands and the world number one right now, Louis Gillard from France. Mattia Camboni, the Italian, putting in a good performance so far in these early stages of the race.
You got that nice little bend just on the right near the end there of that upper peak.
And here they are, round the mark. The leaders came round that a few seconds ago. So let's see how the fleet pans out. There is Louis Gillard of France out in front. He's been having a terrific season, and if this continues, he'll be starting his world championship in the same vein. Camboni of Italy. And then comes the Dutchman. But those distances you can see on the leaderboard, how significant are they in the windsurfing? I mean, if you know, in certain classes of sailing, some of those would almost be uncatchable. But today, here, on these boards?
Well, I think it can change pretty rapidly. If you misjudge a ley line, whether it's in a downwind or on the upwind, and you need to do a double tack, then you can easily lose a lot of meters in those maneuvers. So it's about making the right decisions at the right moments. If the first guys continue to do that, obviously they will keep their lead if they're going to choose also the right side of the race course. But it can change pretty quickly, I would say.
Well, just for Louis Gillard, he only did one tack at that whole beat. Yeah. And he lost 4.5 knots through the tack and nearly 10 metres. So it is quite a significant impact. And when they are tacking, you've got to remember your opposition in these manoeuvres across here. That gap, they're doing 20 knots, 21 knots across the top there. So that can be quite a significant loss. So, yeah, those gaps aren't big at all. Nice jibes there. Just thinking about where you could do all your wind your sailing training in this fleet. Just spend all your time in Hawaii, wouldn't you?
Well, I think a lot of them do live in the US, actually.
Yeah.
Moved there to train, certainly during the European winter, anyway. Sitting there in fifth place, the European silver medalist, Byron Kokkolanis of Greece. He is certainly one of the pretenders after Dorian van Rysselberghe's crown. And here is the Dutchman, sitting comfortably in third place. And I wonder if he's looking around thinking, we're on leg three, I'm going to try and chase the leaders and get a first, or if he's just after consolidating that lead at this point.
Well, it's a topic that we've been talking about a lot this week. It's about consistency at these Worlds. Today is their first day. If you can do top three finishes in all the races, that's great. But Van Rysselberghe is really, really fast in these conditions, so I'm pretty sure that if there is an opportunity for him, he will definitely try to pass them.
There was a big shift to the left are all going down on port jibe before, and you see they're all, the leaders have all bombed across to starboard jibe now. There was a big, quite aggressive shift to the left, and they've all jumped onto it. Gee, they're working hard, aren't they? You could turn up to your aerobics class and dominate the class with the fitness you'd have.
Yeah, the windsurfers are known to be one of the fittest, if not the fittest.
Well, we've seen in the fin class, we saw that consistent pumping action on the downwind. So they are constantly moving, but a little bit less on the upwinds. Whereas in the RSX, it's just non-stop, isn't it?
It's non-stop, and actually the less wind there is, the harder it is for them. It's a little bit the opposite if you compare it to the other Olympic classes. So yeah, these guys and also the women, they are spending a lot of time on their bike, training their heart and doing intervals on the rowing machine. So they're really, really, really fit, and they need to be, because they need to keep the pumping game on all the time, or at least the faster that you can recover in between those pumping sets, the better and the faster that you will keep going during the race.
You know, the other thing that's interesting, the faster they're going, so they're up to 25 knots. Louis is up to 25 knots at the moment. There's a lot of lift comes off the fin, so controlling that fin, if you watched him coming down there, that board was sort of trying to flick up on him a little bit. It's quite tough to control that.
Yeah, and they're doing that by applying pressure with their feet on the board. So in everything they do, they just try to minimize the drag and actually make the board feel as light as possible.
So he's just adjusting his downhill tension there as well, I think. So, and just also grabbing and letting that mast hang out a little bit.
It's not just about holding on, is it?
No.
There's so much else going on as well.
Yep.
Yeah, definitely. And we were earlier talking about the big big lead that Louis Girard was having, and Dorian van Rijsselberg is in the lead right now, so he just made up that 140 meters in that downwind leg.
So we have a lead change at gate three, and it's flip-flopping between Girard and van Rijsselberger, who closed the gap on the leader. And Kokkelanis is also having a great race. He's up there in the hunt in third place.
So the wind's quite a long way on the right. We've had we had that big left move that I mentioned before, and then you would have noticed, if you're watching closely, they all jibe back onto port, and we had a move to the right, and it's still in the right. So anyone on starboard's probably making a little bit of a gain at the moment. It's about to start coming back the other way. As we've said, it's like yesterday, there was a lot of volatility in this race. So we've actually got our two leaders going to the opposite direction. So this will give us a good indication of just how things go.
Yeah, a fascinating split. Who has taken the right decision? Is that a tactical split, or is that just because they've seen different conditions?
Yeah, I'd say it'd be the way they came down into that bottom mark, set them up really what they want to do.
To me, it looks like the right-hand side looks better at the moment.
Yeah.
You can see that the angle to the wind is just a little bit better than the men that are on the left side.
Yeah. So just to give you some idea, I did a little bit of number crunching with the 49er FXs, what we watched yesterday, and the length of their windward, the leg that they have to sail, is pretty much equal to the leg length that we've sailed here. And they averaged sail. They covered about 1.8 to 2 kilometres, 1.8 of a kilometre to 2 kilometres sailing upwind by the time they tacked their way upwind. The windsurfers are doing between 2.5 and 2.7 kilometres to move upwind for the same distance. So that's showing you. But there's a significant speed difference, obviously. So they're going sailing a lot further, but going a lot faster. And that's the whole notion behind this, I guess what you would call this formula board shape design, the whole thing. I'm so old, Evie, that I actually remember the race where we used to race, you know, longboards or fun boards, they were called in the days, and you'd sail them the same as a dinghy, bit centre board down, upwind. And one of the pros, a long, long time ago, had a problem with his board, so he took his slalom board out in a windy day, and he did exactly what we're seeing here and won the race by a long way. So it was by accident that we discovered to go faster this way. But I'm so old now that I remember that.
And there you can see the leader, Dorian van Rysselberghe, just edging ahead of Briton Tom Squires, who fell down the fleet earlier on leg two, but he's back up in the mix. Louis Girard, our leader earlier on, down to fourth now, the man from Brittany, fighting to get back to the front.
Yeah, he's gone a long way left, but he's had to go back out to the left. He tried to come back into the centre, so he's done a couple of tacks now, which is unusual in this fleet. They try and minimise the tacks, given the discussions we've had before, just explaining the distance that they lose and comparative to the speed everyone else is doing. You can see there the difference in height, that sailor just three from the right, not sailing as close to the wind as the others, so I think that's going to cost them through this. Now remember, this is the when they get to this top mark, this is it from here. They race downwind and then reach into the finish. So this is the last time they sail back upwind.
Well, we just saw a nice tactical move of van Rysselberghe,
yep,
who tacked right on top of the British Tom Squires to just keep in control and maybe bring him all the way to that right lay line to make sure that he stays in front.
And Guillard he went back onto starboard, and now I think the wind's starting to come back to him, so he's going to try and bring it back to the centre line for us. So he might come back into play here. So you can see Guillard there right on the bottom of screen. His angle, like, he's not crossed by anyone, so if it is lifted on port slightly, it's pretty stable for the moment. He could come back into play. He's got a nice clear lane to come in, and it looks like he's got plenty of place, Evie, to my eye.
Yeah, well, it will depend on how that last wind shift is gonna go towards. He's pretty far out on the left lay line, though. If anything happens, it would be hard for him.
It's slowly trying to creep left, I think. But I don't think he's going to pass them. But I think he's not going to lose them.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, this is the man to keep an eye on right now. Dorian van Rysselberghe, the Dutchman out in front, heading up to the top mark for the final time. He looks around. Where's the opposition? Where's the wind? Reads it immediately, and he's off again.
Yeah, I think he's going after Louis Girard. Actually, he's probably noticing that he's gaining some ground on him and not taking too much risk.
Yeah. It's interesting, isn't it? I think that really is just starting to bend left, so I've got a suspicion Girard might actually come out in front here.
Yeah, it looks like it.
Just on the analytics, it's showing Dorian's coming back with a bit of a knock. So we might even see a couple of others come in from the left that we haven't spotted before. Sam Sills might be worth keeping our eye on as well from Great Britain. Yeah, there you go. You can see that on the overhead there, on the virtual reality shot.
The wind is really shifting back left, actually, now.
Yeah.
Going from 300 down to 285 now.
That looks so awkward, that technique. Now, I've got a very, very good friend of mine who's won a lot of championships in these class, in the pro class of these boards. And he argues that you don't hold that front strap like they do, but he's the only one that does it that way. We've had long discussions about this. Can you believe it? How boring my life is that we talk about these things over a few beers. So you can see that the sailors dropped back, really doing a tactical analysis there at the moment. So Louis would be looking for his lay line. I think he can't be very... Well, there you go. He'll be coming into this lay line now.
He's travelled a really long distance across the course, hasn't he, Girard?
He has. I'll try and give you some idea. Yeah, well, it's a really good spot there, mate. So he's done 3.3 kilometres already, but so has Dorian. So they have travelled quite a significant distance. Yeah.
The number one of his ranking in the world, France 1.
Yeah, and he's heading for that. He's heading for that top mark where van Rysselberghe still needs to put two tacks in.
Yeah.
So he will be leading by quite some distance, I think.
Yeah, he did it well. Like, he didn't look too good when he went off that other side, but, you know, that's the nature of this racing. You've got to really nail when you come off that bottom mark and when you come off the top mark. You've absolutely got to nail what that wind is going to do. They're only doing two or three tacks, or one tack or two tacks, actually.
They want to minimise those tacks. So we split again here. We've got a split again here. This is interesting. So these two are really throwing it at each other. I'd say we're going to see quite a battle with these two throughout the racing. They look to be a class above at the moment, don't they? Look at that gust.
So our leaders are round and heading towards that finish line at the bottom of the course. Quite a gap between first and second. And that position has been changing throughout the whole race. It's a fascinating cat-and-mouse battle between Giard of France and Van Rysselberger of the Netherlands. Giard has been working hard on the Olympic circuit all year and has earned that world ranking of number one. Won a couple of events, one in Miami in the World Cup Series in January, second on home waters in Yeah in the spring. Van Rysselberger, though, has taken a little bit of time out with his family to reacquaint himself with his wife and child. And his ranking, as a result, is further down than you would normally expect. But right now, Giard is in control and he is lengthening the lead on Dorian Van Rysselberger. Over 200 metres between them now. But a good performance from the Brit, Sam Sills. And Nimrod Mashiach of Israel has moved up the fleet as well.
Van Rysselberger did a couple of jibes there looking for pressure, and the whole time he tried to go out on a different split. And unfortunately for him, Giard was in a massive gust and he just rode away from him, so he had to jibe back and come back to him. So that's where he dropped that 80 metres in terms of distance to Giard. So that is what's cost him, and he's really nailed this downwind run at the moment. So just he'll be laying in for this jibe soon to this bottom mark. Won't be too far from laying in. He's actually just jibed there. I can't see him on the camera, so I'm just trying to work it out on the analytics. Remember, there's two fleets on the water here, so if you're looking behind the screen and go, who's that? That's the blue fleet as well, you can see out there, so just don't get confused. Jibe he's done here is really just to a defensive play. He's actually just trying to stay in front of Van Rysselberger. He's not worried about extending here at the moment, and this jibe back is for exactly the same reason. So he should be on the lay into the gate or the bottom mark now, and then he has to go to that mark five first and then jibe and head into the finish. So he's just positioned himself to stay in front of the fleet. That's exactly what he's been doing. Being quite defensive, he managed to extend his lead, and he's just been defensive on this run in here. So barring anything untoward, he should have a win here.
It's been a pretty consistent performance from the leaders. They've chopped and changed between themselves, but they've always been there in first, second or third, including Sam Sills and Thomas Goyard. And it'd be interesting to see that battle for third as well as they come into the finish line. But right now, Louis Giard begins the short leg to that finish line. The man from Brittany showing his intent and proving that he is still on form. The form that he has shown throughout the season so far, he is now taking into the World Championships. So a great first victory for Louis Giard in the very first race of the RSX men. And he will be very pleased with that. Second place for Dorian Van Rysselberger. Always calm, cool and collected, and has raced a very good race here as well, and has shown that he will be a tough man to beat overall. Sam Sills of Great Britain heads towards the finish line. Looks like third place will be going to him, with Thomas Goyard of France right behind him. And Thomas Squires also still in the mix. We'll watch them come in. But it's Sam Sills in third. In the end, the battle for third was fairly straightforward, with Sills getting ahead, Thomas Goyard in fourth, and then Tom Squires, also Great Britain, in fifth with the Israeli and the Italian, Mattia Camboni, who challenged for the lead in the early stages in the mix as well. Matteo Sanz-Lantz of Switzerland coming in eighth place, the world silver medalist from last year. And then we had Sebastian Wang Hansen of Norway. And the top 10 were finished off by Ivan Pastor Lafuente of Spain. Disappointing, though, for Byron Kokkolanis, who was up there with the best of them earlier on and was challenging. But on that final upwind leg, he sort of followed Louis Girard down that left side. It paid off for the Frenchman, but not for the Greek, who will have to make do with 11th. Piotr Mishka, 12th. Remember, 43 sailors competing. And it's all about where you are at the end of qualifying. So just to explain, we've got a yellow and a blue fleet, over 80 sailors in total, and they're reshuffled at the end of each day. And then after a few days racing and qualification, we will merge them into a gold and silver fleet as we jettison those who don't make the cut. Then the qualifying continues as we try and find the top 10 who will take part in the medal race next weekend. So it's all about consistency. It's all about getting those positions. Every position counts. And you need to get them in the early stages, because you don't want to get to the end of your qualifying and then look back and think, oh, if I'd only just made one or two places in the early races, I could be going to the medal race.
Yeah, the other thing, I guess, that's probably worth discussing watching this fleet, the with the trapezoid course, they do an upwind, one straight upwind, and then they reach across. And that reach, that first reach being so early in the race, does spread the fleet slightly. So it makes that first beat super critical to the result. So, you know, that needs to be considered by these sailors when they're going upwind. You've really got to nail your first beat. You've got to be right there or thereabouts as you come into that top mark. And in all honesty, the whole fleet was almost there. You know, they came in en masse at that top mark. It really was only a little wind shift towards the end that sort of made that final difference where we got the separation. But once they went around and reached across the top there, then we started to spread the fleet, because you know, they're doing 13, 14 knots upwind, and then they're doing 20 knots on that first reach. So it was a good opportunity to spread out.
Matt Carey of Malta there, crossing the finish line down the fleet. See it from the graphic now. 38th place for him. You've got to remember, it's an open championship, so yes, you have the world's top sailors here, but there are individuals who've entered off their own back as well. And how much will they be learning from the top guys? What an opportunity it is for them to just, well, challenge themselves against the best, but also to take a walk around the boat park and see how these windsurfs are set up, get some advice.
We also talked yesterday, mate, the 49er FX is, you know, it was a sprint course, 30 minutes. We're expecting for that just to do their courses yesterday, and we're saying how it's going to be quick racing. 23 minutes it took for the leaders to get around that course, 23 minutes. So that's a fairly quick coverage. And, you know, that's a direct relationship to the wind strength that we're seeing now on the course, of sort of that 15 to 18 knots. And, yeah, so it's pretty cool.